to the April 13th, 2016 Select Board meeting. I'd like to call this meeting to order. First thing on our agenda will be reorganization of the Select Board. I'll make the first motion to appoint Molly Keegan as Chairman of the Board.
I'll second that motion.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Why not you, Joyce?
I don't have as much time on it as I would like to right now. Maybe if I retire, but I haven't retired yet.
You announcements tonight? I just was wondering.
No. Not yet. There's a lot of work that goes into being the chair, so. That would be, Molly would like to accept it.
Yeah, that's fine with me.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I'll abstain.
Four to one.
3-1-1.
Did you nay?
No, yeah.
Nay, and abstention.
No, you said yes.
You did say that.
Yeah.
I apologize.
Four, 0-1.
Thank you.
I thought I heard correctly.
You're right. I'm sorry.
I got my hearing. And for the clerk?
You guys want to change seats and she can call that for you?
We need to do that now?
You can change seats and then you can call.
Formalities.
Joyce, it was not a long tenure.
No, just.
We're going to miss you.
It's my 14th year.
Oh, you got us all.
Thank you, sir.
I know you guys can't see this.
Oh, come on, let's have a little fun with it tonight.
All right, then, should we entertain a motion for, as part of the reorganization, for the clerk? Would anybody like to make a motion?
A motion, Joyce Chungwell, for clerk.
Do I have a second?
You got time for that, Joyce?
Sure.
Okay, so is there a second?
I'll second the motion.
Thank you, Donald. Any discussion? No? Okay, so all of those in favor in appointing Joyce Chungwell clerk for this season?
Aye.
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 Aye. Okay, so it's unanimous. All right, well, thank you, everybody. Let the games begin. So first order of business, we have a consent agenda this evening. But actually, I think before we go into that, I just wanted to thank Guilford Mooring for his 3 years of service to the Select Board. I think, Guilford, by and large, did a fine job. He worked very, very hard. And I know that the hard work that he put in and his sense of humor will be missed. So thank you, Guilford Mooring.
You're here.
Same.
Okay, the consent agenda this evening, we have the minutes for March 2nd, 9th, and 30th for approval. We have the weekly warrants. Do I need to say the numbers?
We can fill those in, but the warrants that are in front of you at this point, there are four of them, two payroll and two accounts payable.
Okay. Thanks, David. And then we have a senior center ad hoc building committee, and the appointment of that ad hoc committee is requested by Council on Aging.
Right, and what they've done is they've requested that this be an ad hoc committee of the Council on Aging, so there's no appointment by the Select Board required in this particular case, so that could be removed from the agenda.
Can you speak louder?
Sure. Senior Centers, the Council on Aging has said that this will be an ad hoc committee for their purposes, so it doesn't require a town Select Board appointment.
Motion accept.
Second.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. Okay, so it is a little bit after 7 o'clock, and we do have time for a public comment period. So again, just a reminder to folks with the public comment period, the Select Board is here to listen to any public comments that are made. We are not here to respond. But again, if you make a public comment, if it warrants a response at a later point in time, I'm happy to do so. Okay, Mr. Michikowski?
I asked last week about that ad hoc committee on medical marijuana as a representative from the planning board. I understand they had a meeting there, and according to Mr. Nixon, Happy Valley thinks, I don't know what he said, if he thinks I'm in conflict or something. And again, I want to gather as much information prior to our hearing, not during the hearing or after the hearing. And I can't understand why the selectman would not appoint me on there. Is there any answer?
Again, it's public comment, so.
I asked that last week. So when do I get a comment, after the process is all done?
Yeah, we can discuss it after the fact and get back to you.
When?
Within the next 48 hours.
Next 48 hours.
Okay.
Okay.
Not meeting next, no, we don't know, right? You can list this agenda for the next meeting if you want. Would you like to be on the agenda for the next meeting?
Well, I'll tell you, if I don't have the information, I'm going to vote no, and if you don't, we're going to have another lawsuit on our hands. I need to have all the information before I cast a vote.
Right, no, I'm just saying, within the next 48 hours, we could talk to determine what the best courses of action are to get that information, and then as Jerry says.
I really don't want it secondhand.
No, as Jerry says, we can put it on the agenda for the next meeting.
I want to hear firsthand. Secondly, the barricades on Route 47, Fort River Bridge. What reason are those barricades on there and construction is not begun? That is really a pain, you're given tickets, DOT is, the state police, I don't know if the Hadley police. But if they're not going to work on it, what in the heck are those barricades there for? And there's a lot of weight, if they're talking about weight, just tens of thousands of pounds of weight with that, those concrete, and it's a big inconvenience for everybody down that end of town. And even like the fire truck, they can't go through, they're going to go around it.
Okay, thank you.
And thirdly, I asked about an article for the infrastructure. Does this board intend to put any article for an override to address our infrastructure? And probably would request maybe either $1 or $2 million to start the program off as override vote for water, sewer, and drainage.
Okay, thank you.
When will I get an answer on that?
Again, that's something we'd have to discuss at a Select Board meeting, so we'd have to talk about putting it on an agenda as a discussion topic.
I hope that's before the town meeting.
We'll be meeting again before town meeting.
That's nice.
Okay, anything else? Does anyone else have, I'm sorry, John, are you, is that it for you?
What's that?
Are you done with your public comment? Okay, does anybody else want to speak to public comment?
I actually do. Only because of, yesterday I was bombarded with a lot of information regarding the temperature at the polling positions. And a recommendation was made by Jeff Mish that we, instead of having it at the senior high school, to do it at the elementary school. That was their recommendation, not mine. I'd like to look into see whether or not that can be done. He says that the problem will go away with the temperature in the room if we do it at the junior high, at the elementary school. So I'd like to investigate if that can get done. Right, Willie?
Oh, yeah.
I can't believe you sat quiet back there. I thought you were going to lambaste us.
Okay, now you opened the can of worms. Yeah, it'll definitely go away because we won't be there. If they don't know how to turn a thermostat on, that's their problem. And the problem they have in the cafeteria, they've known about that for at least five or 6 years. Because I showed them what was wrong. I had a contractor there, gave them a price on repairing the heat in the area there by the stage. And, oh, we can't do that. So what do they do? Instead of spending $100,000 for heating system, they get a generator, $130,000 for a generator they can't use anyway.
Well, I think it was a good suggestion he had, and I think it's...
I think it stinks.
Don't like it? Okay.
Okay, well, thank you for your public comment as well. So if there's no further public comment, then we'll move forward. We don't, we do have a 7:50.
Did it heat up by the end of the evening, or?
Oh, yeah, because Tim Nyhart came down with four little heaters. In fact, it's, one of them was from the Joan Zutsko's desk. Took her electric heater out of there, and Tim had a couple at his house. And we put electric heaters under the chairs of the women that were there.
So. I mean, when we were in the gym, it was, there was icicles in there, and when they finally did turn the heat on, it did warm up in the gym.
Yes. And the reason they said why that they don't want to turn the heat up in the gym is because too much heat is going to ruin their brand new floor.
No. Can we take this offline?
Yep.
I mean, I think the point's been made, and...
But you got...
Yeah, no, I'm just, is that okay, John?
Yeah,
okay.
I mean, however we fix it,
it needs
there.
To be fixed.
I'm just trying to be polite.
All right.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Right.
Appreciate it.
That's as far as he's going.
We're coming up on 7:15. It's a little bit early for the 7:15 appointment. So do we want to take the craft fair old business?
Mm-hmm. Sounds good.
All right. So David, this was a request from the same folks who ran the craft fair.
That's right. So they were at your last meeting. They were not able to be here this evening, so they did their presentation during the public comment period. We said that we would follow up on tonight's meeting to see if the use of the common and permission to use the crafts fair. And they're looking for a date June 11th between 10 a.m. and 4 p.m. Held the same event back in October 25th. Ms. Murphy has been in touch with the chief of police, is that correct?
Not this time around yet.
Not this time around.
The last time we talked, we spoke extensively.
Okay.
Myself and the fire chief. I believe Tim Nyhart was in there as well.
Yeah, I was going to say, it looks like we have approval from the police department dated today. Hadley Fire Department and the inspector?
Yep. Same regulations as last time. The exact same rules that were set by the select board and I believe the planning committee as well.
Mm-hmm.
No parking on the common if it rains, things like that.
Yep.
So it's going to be on the south end?
Mm, yes.
Yep. And so the restrictions include?
So help with overflow parking similar to the upcoming Asparagus Festival, overflow could be in Hopkins Academy. People can stay on the sidewalk, same side of the street, safer, things like that.
So the only request is that they call the police department to schedule the officers.
Correct.
And then from Tim Nyhart, keeping signs back from the edge of the road for line of sight maintenance.
I reiterate my conversation from last year. If it's a person that's from the town of Hadley, I have no problem. They're taxpayers in the town of Hadley. But when somebody comes in from out of town and utilizes our resource like that, I think we should be charging these people to use the town common.
And last time you asked for analysis of how much it cost us to provide services for an event of that type. And I came up with a figure of about $3,600. So if you're interested in assessing a fee, that would be a fee that we could depend.
And I don't know where that would come from. I mean, they're going to pay the police officers themselves, correct?
Yep.
They're going to pay that directly. Okay.
So is that something you'd like to entertain prospectively, but not given the fact this is in process?
If it's in process, then I'll be happy to let it go this year, but I don't think it should go another year without having this addressed.
Is that something that we can make a note to get on a future agenda?
Sure.
Does anybody else have anything that they want to say?
They're already paying for the police.
Mm-hmm.
So where are we getting $3,000?
I'm sorry?
Where's $3,000 coming up from if they're already paying for the police? They're already paying for services.
Yeah, this was something that the board asked me to look into in terms of how much time it took for the building inspector, wiring inspector, DPW, police personnel that are not actually doing the patrolling, as well as the benefits associated with that and the other ancillary costs of municipal government. So that's the number that came out at the end of that analysis.
Well, I would suggest she essentially transferred all of the issues that were brought up last year onto her new request.
Mm-hmm.
My suggestion would be to simply add something in there that asking her to get onto the agenda before she requests next year so that you can talk about the fees.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, like I said, she just transferred everything, so mm-hmm. if it's on this year's, she'll know to do it next year.
Any additional discussion on the craft fair?
Were you able to get a letter off to the state about the crosswalks?
Email. Yeah, I haven't heard back yet.
No response.
Looking
for motion to accept.
So the only other thing is June 11th, we'll probably be well into the Route 9 widening project, even though the craft fair is not going to be in the project area. It'll certainly be traffic considerations. So any approval tonight should be subject to any order of conditions issued by the chief of police.
This request is actually for two separate dates, one on June 11th and one on October 15th. Are we just doing one at this point in time?
One at this time.
Yeah.
Okay. I'll make a motion that we allow the application for On Trend Crafts for June 11th, 2016.
Is there a second?
Subject to
any other restrictions.
The application's been filled out and the stipulations are on the application.
Second.
I would say subject to any order of conditions issued by the chief of police. We simply don't know what the state of Route 9 is going to be like by June 11th.
Friendly amendment is heeded.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Are you okay with the second on that? Mm-hmm. Okay. Any further discussion?
Yes. Is it possible to attach an addendum to that and say possible fees might be charged in October? Because that's a whole other event. To give them a little warning ahead of time?
I think it would be fair to let them know that
sure.
prior to October, the board's going to be discussing the matter.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, and that's something we can just take care of. We don't need to make it part of the motion, correct? All right, so all of those in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? Excellent. Okay, so now we're just a little bit late for our 7:15 appointment with Park and Rec. Welcome.
And the rest of the crew in here. Full house. Hey,
Rob. Hi, Alms.
Hello.
Hello. Can I just put this right here? Can you have a little cash?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm here as a liaison between the Park and Rec Department and a friend of mine, Linda at the park. I appreciate you asking us to be here today.
And Kathy, do you want to just let everybody at home know who is here representing Park and Rec?
Yeah, sure. I'm Kathy Zaturka, the program coordinator. With me are the commissioners, Diane Karras, Andy Kothaki, and Ken Baresca. And again, I'm the liaison. Between the friends of Zaturka Park and John, who usually and has been working tirelessly on this project, is unavailable today. So I'm going to be here on his behalf. And there's a fold-out map in that and more. Actually, why don't I give it to you guys too, the commissioners, so you can kind of follow along. So here we are. So we've asked, we had a meeting with the CPA committee and we asked for them for $88,000. They unanimously accepted it as a project worthwhile to use the $88,000 funds. The commissioners a few months back said that if the $88,000 was a voted yes during the town meeting, that an additional $20,000 would be taken from the George Edwards Fund. So those two items are up for voting this town meeting on May 5th. We ask that you support it. The funding is for the budget we have that is on, I think, your third page. Just very quickly, we're calling it a green space. It has been and was a baseball, softball field for years. That would be here where some of us remember playing. But now we'll just have it as an open field, garden area here. We have UMass. Actually, a professor of landscaping at UMass has offered to help us with that and thought maybe they could even bring their class here with their students to help us out with this. We have a lot of volunteers in the community, some also at the, from the Ag Department and Stockbridge School of UMass helping us out with some of this when it gets to that. But again, here is the green space, and this is a blacktop area where we plan to have basketball hoops, maybe even a wall for like pitching, I can't think of it right now, a target, you know, like painted on soccer fields, lacrosse fields. So that would be kind of going on here. Again, lined by trees, and this is a natural amphitheater. Some of you remember there's a field in the back and a hill. There's a natural amphitheater here. We're hoping for a stage that we can possibly have programming going on there, maybe a show a couple nights a week, summer. And then up here is an upper field along with a pavilion. Parking is already existing there, but we're going to be changing the fence, and we're hoping to have a fence that opens up so that when in the event of an event, we can use this lower field for additional parking as well.
Are you taking down the backstop?
We are. The fence there is no longer really very usable or safe. There's some broken parts to it. So we're planning on putting a fence tall enough so that it won't be interfering, you know, balls won't be going into the intersection there. Of course, we'll take that into consideration.
Any comments or questions for Kathy from the board?
You said there's a person from UMass that's going to be working on this? That's a design person?
This is a concept right now.
Right now,
without
yeah.
our monies, we don't have a specific design. As you can see, we've come as far with budgeting and so forth. But yes, we're considering Berkshire Design as sort of on hold to work on the concept, moving the concept to the design.
But you came up with some numbers here,
yes,
and
you
did that
calling
off of
all
something.
Calling all of the people, asking. The excavators have come. And really, there's two different excavating companies that we just asked, because asking one, we weren't sure before we asked for the final amount of money, how much it actually would be. And excavators look at it as a cleanup, fix-up project. It really does require, because as people have heard in the past, it was a stump dump, and the town back in the day, in the 60s, took that stump dump from where it was and moved it into a viable play yard for all of us with tennis courts and that sort of thing. So now the excavators have come back to us and said, we can do that again, if you will, by sort of stirring it all up and packing it down and putting loam and then grass. Not being a pro and having them not here, I'm hoping everybody sort of can understand the language. And so that would go here, it would go further all the way in here so that we can get rid of the what is there, a tennis court, but it's in very bad shape. And then putting some blacktop down for, again, that basketball. And then up here doing the same sort of excavating and a little more because it wasn't a field. But in terms of final costs, we haven't had those. These are all estimates to find out what we've asked for, to get a ballpark of where we are. And as you can see, we're looking for donations. And there's about $30,000 shy of what we're asking for currently. And we're hoping, as you have said, Jerry, the people from UMass, the landscaping artists, the professors there, and some of the ag people from Stockbridge and so forth have coming forth and volunteering. So of course those funds will be there as well.
Kathy, have neighbors been notified?
Neighbors have been notified. Many of the neighbors are friends. And that is actually how this all started. The commissioners were working pretty hard on this project a few years back, but we couldn't get as far as we are because of the funding had to come from capital. Now CPA is allowing funding from CPA for projects like this. So it changes the tune, but the commissioners invited the neighbors to come, and the neighbors said, please don't get rid of it. And so together they partnered to start the ball rolling, and of course the neighbors really did. So we appreciate the Friends of Zaterka Park and all their work.
Are you going to incorporate, I watched the planning board the other night,
yes,
and they made some wonderful comments, and
yes,
they endorsed your project too.
Yes,
but
thank you.
The yellow marking on there is an existing road.
Huge.
And they suggested parking. The pavilion possibly could hold, it's 20 by 40, could hold 60, maybe 70 people.
Mm-hmm.
And that entails a lot of automobiles coming there. And the planning board has suggested to make a loop and go all the way around and come back out.
Mm-hmm.
So you'd be able to have diagonal parking all the way there, and you'd accommodate 50 cars, no problem. And you still could drive around the cars, so
mm-hmm,
in case
that's
there was emergency.
That's
which
true.
Made a lot of sense to me too.
Right, and we did talk to the Mikes, and we did talk a little bit about certainly involving them when we do the final plan to be able to get emergency vehicles up and around. Or, you know, the pavilion is here right now. When we do finally get the site design, it may say that it should be down here, further closer to the first field. Again, having this be a concept is where we thought it should be because of the amphitheater area. But as you can see, all of the elements are here. They may change slightly, but here are the elements of what the new park will be for all of you.
The amphitheater reminds me of years ago on the Common when we had the Arts Council.
Oh, yeah.
And they had concerts there, big band series.
Yeah.
That would be a wonderful place to entail
That's
that again.
What we're hoping for is a really great community pocket park for everyone, yourself and kids.
Restrooms?
The restrooms will be, the pavilion is actually hoping to house restrooms in another phase. But right now, Park and Rec does use sandy cans. We use them at the school fields during our summer. We use it at the senior center. We will have sandy cans at this facility. There is running water. There's a faucet down there. I'm not sure if anyone remembers, but at the corner. So there is running water there, but the sandy cans will be used for the time being.
Kathy, could I just ask about the ongoing maintenance?
Sure. So I've talked to Mike Klamoski, and actually Marlo, our new director, is instrumental in the park in Greenfield, or mm-hmm, several of them, and he knows all about parks and how to maintain them. In fact, we're going to walk this park together soon. I'm letting him not be so busy. But he's really up for helping us and giving us great ideas, and so yes, we have talked to them. They already maintain the field. They maintain it as well as they can.
Okay, I didn't realize they were doing anything.
They mow the lawn and take care of it as best they can for what it is. So we've all sort of chuckled a bit and said that if it's better off, the mowing will probably take less because they're not going to avoid the divots, if you will. So yes, I have talked to them, and as I said, Marlo will be instrumental in, I think, some fantastic planning as he has done in Greenfield.
Okay. So there would be some ongoing budget impact for that maintenance?
I'm assuming that they'll have to continue with what they're doing right now,
right,
and
but then
and there
the question
may be
is just
more.
If there's more, yeah. So we'd, at some point we'd want estimates on that as well.
Okay.
How about the cleanup of the field so that you could get some of this going? How would that work out?
The Friends are actually thinking about having a field cleaning right now. It's filled with a lot of
brush
and part of the excavating, the two estimates that the excavators came in, they're well aware of all of that, and we thought that we would take a chipper and use those fallen brush to our advantage, and of course mulch is good anywhere, and we'll use that throughout the park. But you're right, there's some brush work that we can do. I know the neighbor actually has done a lot of it on his own, just trying to help us out. So.
The fitness loop, what type of composition would it be?
The fitness loop here?
Yes.
I mean, if we do a fitness loop?
Mm-hmm.
Well, we've talked about having outdoor fitness equipment, but that's really expensive because this is a nice place to run and walk on, and they're outdoor you know, weights or just jump over a bear, whatever, squats, and I don't know, who's an exercise person, I hear you tell me. Anyway, we have looked into that, you know, to sort of be putting it in here. I think that one of the places in Deerfield has it. It's an outdoor exercise. They're very expensive, but, you know, you never know, maybe a company will want to give us two or three and have their name on it as a donation.
But I was just wondering, like the walking loop, would it be something like a track?
That's
what I meant, the composition.
So,
what would they be walking on?
Yeah, so right now it's basically lawn, and we will do the natural lawn that it is right now. It'll maintain. But we own 4 acres here, and eventually this field we're hoping to be a lot like the one in North Amherst. As you know, the paths and the forests there, with just sort of natural pine tree, clean, just walkway. But yeah, this is just lawn and what it is in the natural elements right now.
So Kathy, is there information you want the folks at home to know about this project? In terms of
other
what
than
next
what
steps are?
Yeah, so the next step is vote yes at town meeting on May 5. And then we can talk steps, but that's for sure. I can maybe talk a little more about that at town meeting. But, you know, if we do get the yes vote, then we're able to start this project right away, which is really exciting in our climate right now in this town, that we can really have a good opportunity to get this going with just a yes vote from our community. And we will start it right away, and you'll have a park. So.
Anything else from the board?
No,
sounds like a
no.
Plan of works.
Thanks.
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify something here. I'm a park and rent commissioner, but also I've been on the CPA committee since its existence, which is about 12 years. When we were approached with this project, we weren't quite sure which things we could be able to do, such as a pavilion or whatever. So we did contact Boston, so everything on there has been cleared. And Kathy mentioned something about maintenance. Now, one of the biggest things in CPA money cannot be used for maintenance. So I just want to reassure everybody that all these certain areas are going to be new areas. In other words, we're not trying to maintain a baseball field that was there, or put up a backstop that's, you know, mm-hmm. In other words, any maintenance. This is all going to be, you know, brand new projects.
Okay. I think it'll be important to stress that.
Right.
Okay.
I'd be a little concerned about parking cars on the newly resettled soil on that lower green promptly after the park is completed. I think that you should delay, you know, having an event with cars, especially if the turf is wet. It might mar it up for quite some time.
I actually think the planning board was looking for a little more of a little different service than loam, so that there would be mm-hmm. two vehicles wide. One could be parked, and one could be a roadway to be used. So I don't think it was loam that they were looking for.
Yeah, that's why I said I'm a layman on that.
Mr.
So thank
yeah,
you
yeah,
for
I,
that clarification.
I was sitting on it when they come in there with that presentation. And I know I brought that up about continuing that where one car
right here.
All the way around.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I did
park,
forget that. 100%.
So it would take the cars off the road, mm-hmm. and also there's enough room for an ambulance to run around.
You're 100% right. Thank you for reminding me. Right here is exactly where we were talking about.
You're right, all the way around.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, any more discussion? Is that? Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
We'll see you,
Tommy.
Yes.
Molly, I would like to just add one thing.
Sorry. Yeah.
I don't know if a lot of people know, but they named that Zaterka Park after the guy, Joe Zaterka, that was the highway superintendent, planted trees all over this community. The trees could only talk. The guy was, his whole heart was into to Hadley, and that's a tribute to him, and I support that 100%.
Thank you.
Did you
appreciate
want some
that.
Of these back?
You can have them if you'd like.
I think I have the last one.
You
and
do,
I,
yes.
You put a lot of work into it, and I just...
Well, I appreciate it. Spread the word.
You're going to pass them around town meeting? floor?
They'll have some kind of, they'll have some kind of display.
Okay.
Okay, thanks, Kathy.
Thank you.
Next item on the agenda is the annual town meeting warrant and the FY 2017 budget. This is actually a joint meeting with our finance committee this evening. So I think that's what most everybody's here for, so we might as well move right into that.
Does everybody need a handout on the budget of where we are?
Thank you. So, David, correct me if I'm wrong, but tonight what we're looking for is the select board to actually sign the warrant?
Yes.
Mark, did you want to pick it up?
Yeah, I just wanted to, there was a couple articles in particular that were in limbo the last time we spoke. Specifically, Article 11. Remember, we broke that into two articles.
Anybody need a warrant?
Sorry, David. Left it at home.
Page 8 on the left from the last warrant that I have.
Article 11.
We were waiting to see what that 300,000 number was going to come in.
Right, and Mark, just for folks at home, could you, just while we're sitting here looking at it, could you just talk about what that article is?
Oh, to see if the town will authorize the treasurer to borrow, transfer from available funds, $350,000 for capital expenses. One is an owner's project manager for municipal buildings, development program with priority for the development of a future senior center. Expenses estimated at $50,000 or land. The motion two is the land and purchase of future buildings. Expenses estimated at $300,000 to be determined by bid. And specifically, the bid was supposed to be opened
Friday.
This coming Friday. I thought it was last Friday.
Point of clarification on that, I think the $50,000 was agreed upon.
Correct.
It's only the second.
Right. I was just reading the whole article. So
Friday.
I apologize. I thought it was last Friday that we were going to get the bids opened on that.
No, I think it's the North Hadley
Hall tonight.
We have a lot of bids.
I know.
Right.
I've been trying to keep them straight.
So we're actually going to want to handle that tonight too.
Yes, please.
Want to defer that until later? And
that would be fine.
And what's the second?
What was the second one?
Yeah.
Second article you were wondering about?
The move to appropriate the $550,000 for the purpose of purchasing land, general government purposes, including the payment of all costs incidental related to, and then meet this appropriation, treasurer with the approval of the select board is authorized to borrow the set amount under pursuant to chapter. I'll keep reading it. Chapter 44, section 7.3 of the general laws are pursuant to any other enabling authority and to issue bonds or notes of the town, therefore, provided, however, that the vote be taken here under shall be expressly contingent upon approval by the voters to exclude the amount to pay for the bonds or notes authorized for this purpose from the provisions of Proposition 2.5 or so-called. Yeah.
Okay, so that's Article 15?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
The Finance Committee does not recommend this article at this time. We just can't afford it.
And David, that has not yet gone out to bid, correct?
Right, so we're in a particular situation with this particular article. We have not even gone out to bid on this one. In order for it to be a binding land purchase, we need to identify for the voters, at least in the motion, a parcel has to be sufficiently identified so the voters know what we're actually voting on. So we're kind of caught in a place where we're not really able to take any significant action on this particular article. Unless we're in a situation where we can declare this as a unique acquisition.
Right. Okay. And so Finance Committee is recommending against from an affordability standpoint.
Correct, correct.
And...
Given our existing financial constraints.
Okay. And then, just in terms of the reason this is here at all, has to do with the potential impending sale of North Hadley Hall.
No.
No?
Nothing to do with it.
Nothing to do with it, okay. Go ahead, Billy.
Whole separate item. It's a piece of property that, in North Hadley, 10-acre piece, that we had looked at for the fire department substation.
Right.
And the piece is big enough that we could, in addition to put a fire department there, also have another 5-6 acres or so for use, for other uses, such as park and rack, or...
Ball field.
Or ball field, or a place for senior center, right inside of it, seniors, and that's what that was for. And that, we've been dealing with the individual past almost 2 years now, and the price was a lot higher, and discussion with them the past, actually this afternoon, was $500,000 for all 10 acres.
And I just want to clarify, my point was just that it's really precipitated by, with the decision to sell North Hadley Hall, that kind of kicked off the discussion about the fire station and whether or not we needed a substation in North Hadley. And obviously, if we're moving forward with that, we would need the land acquisition specifically for that. And to your point, you're right, and then it became a more expansive conversation.
Right, so before we move a fire department, or build a fire department, or something, we need a piece of land to put it on. That's where that came from.
Okay, and Chief Spanknebel, could I just ask, the last we left off, I think in discussions with you, the biggest impetus in front of you right now is the fact that there is a fire truck that's going to be arriving in October?
Correct.
Okay, and that fire truck needs to be housed?
That fire truck has a home, however, the truck that needs to get moved out of its way will not.
Okay.
Or it can if modifications are made to the North Hadley Hall at this time.
Right.
Which has been, it was in capital at the same time that we requested the truck.
Right.
Or modifications to the present fire station.
Or modifications, yes, there's been...
To the center of town.
A lot of different concepts.
Right, or temporary housing.
Correct.
On a not permanent basis.
Yes.
We won't leave it out in the cold.
Thank you.
So, David, could you remind us of the procurement rules on this again?
Okay, so anything above, for land transactions, anything above $35,000 in cost has to go out to bid under Mass General Law, Chapter 30A, Section 30B, Section 16. This requires 30-day notification in the Central Registry, newspaper notice, posting for 30 days in Town Hall, and you have to test the market, basically. The exceptions are two. One is that if you have Chapter 61A land that's coming out of Chapter 61A, you have right of first refusal. So that's allowed by law without going through the procurement process. There you would be paying the price that is being asked for or agreed upon with another seller. So whatever that price is, you can match that and the land becomes yours. The other is to declare the land a unique acquisition because of its topography, because of its proximity to areas that make it advantageous for the town. You can get a declaration of unique acquisition and dispense with the procurement process. You still have to raise money by town meeting vote, and because it's a town asset that you'd be acquiring, you need the consent of town meeting to acquire the property. You also have to declare what purpose this would be for, whether it be for general government purposes or for highway purposes or for school purposes.
Okay, so Article 15, does it need to have a specific label as to which piece of property it is that people will be looking to town to borrow, or can it be for a piece of property?
You need to identify.
The piece of property.
Yeah.
Okay, so this isn't out to bid. So quite frankly, this article is not something that can be voted on town meeting floor anyways.
Unless you go through the unique acquisition, which you need to draw up a list of characteristics that make this parcel unique as opposed to any other parcel that may be nearby.
Within the next 3 weeks.
Within the next 3 weeks, that's right.
Mr. Kowski?
Yeah, I got a question. Number one, I understand down the road, in the near future, this town is moving towards a full-time fire department. And if that's the case, why are we building a substation? And number two, that this board has known about the North Hadley Hall, why would you order a fire truck if you have no place to put it? It doesn't make any sense to me. Is there any kind of answer to that?
I can explain
the history.
Fire department side, that, like I said, that was put into capital with the request for the truck. So it's been very well known that in order to move the pumper that we need to move up there, there's some modifications need to be done. That's been in capital since before the truck was approved. So because the town decided to sell it, it put everything kind of on this holding pattern. And we've been waiting for the answers. The building committee's been working very hard on it. They're trying to find different options. We're looking at the Montgomery Rose site. So all this stuff goes back to the fact that we were prepared to do modifications on the North Hadley station in order to fit the budget.
And what kind of expense was that?
The expense, it included fixing the envelope and getting some new windows in it so all of our heat's not going out through the roof, but at the time, it was about $192,000.
You said 150, Mike?
$192,000.
But if this town is moving towards a full-time fire department in the near future, I feel it's totally ridiculous to build a substation. Build a nice station, you got 24/7 coverage, and you get responses all over town faster than a volunteer. Wouldn't that be?
I agree if you're talking about, there's been talk about that as well. If you have 24/7 coverage, absolutely, I would be all about that. If there's sufficient 24/7 coverage, we were talking about daytime coverage just to try and put a band-aid on the concern we have now. But without that substation up there at this point, it's, in my opinion, and this is the fire chief who responds to these calls, is not an option.
You know,
other people might disagree with that, but that's my opinion.
Why I say that, Madam Chairman, I served on that public safety complex committee. That thing was under design, and I could foresee, because you read the blueprints, there was a lot of police officers that could never read a blueprint, didn't understand it. When it was built, he said, oh my God, what do we have here? And the thing, I warned him, I said, when they occupy this building, it's gonna be to capacity. I'm telling you right now. And guess what? It was. So I would suggest this board do a serious thinking before spending a lot of taxpayers' money. If you're gonna do something really good and it's gonna benefit the town, look down the road.
So relative to the article, board members, any comment?
I think Mr. Denley was going to tell us about the uniqueness of a piece of property.
That's
all right.
Exactly,
okay.
That's exactly.
Sorry.
Right. We took that under, we found that out also while we were looking at this piece of property.
Mm-hmm.
A number of pieces of properties. I had seven of them. This one was the best because of its location, because of its size, and the specific location, because you could get to the malls by just heading straight down and taking a right on North Maple Street, and you're at the malls. So it's a unique location. It has water, it has sewer, and everything we needed, and it's a unique location for a specific purpose. And so that under that item C there, he was discussing, that's what we went looking for and did away with the other pieces of property that didn't fit the bill as well as this one here. It was unique. And in the interim, with the enlarging of the fire station down here, one, there would have to be more property taken and in order to put in addition onto this fire station. That would also mean more property for the trucks. Then you'd also have to have rooms for sleeping quarters and kitchen equipment, so on and so forth. So we didn't come with a definitive figure on this, but yet, because this is one avenue that we weren't sure we wanted to go with, and we were led by the answers we've got from the selectmen and from the fire department and police department that we'd be tearing the whole building apart in order to do the job properly to the public safety building and inconveniencing the police department and the fire department, trying to make all the changes in property, parking, daytime for the building. So this is why we figured it would be right now, seeing how we're looking for a place. We've got a nice piece of property that's dual purpose, and we could also use that piece of property, which we need, and if we can't get any in town for the senior center or a building for Park and Rec, then that is a piece of property that will have dual purpose. So, you know, and if the selectmen would like, we could get some ideas on putting an addition to that fire department, but it's going to be a heck of a lot cheaper just to buy a piece of property and start brand new with the site and in its unique location right on Route 47.
Okay. Thanks, Willie.
I think the phasing in of the full-time fire department is going in phases and steps, where we talked about this ad nauseum over the past 3 years about how we need to do these things, because we're selling North Hadley Hall. That's a given. It's going. So we need to do something to house something up there in North Hadley. But given the response times of a fire being up there, we have firefighters that are in North Hadley that can just get to the scene right then and there. From the time that we're spread out so far now, there certainly is a need for some substation up there in North Hadley. And we've all come to the conclusion on that. So I think that's where all this is going. We're not going right into a full-time fire department at this time, but a daytime fire department with on-call at night is something that we've looked at. And I think that's where we're going at this point.
Don?
Yeah, it really doesn't pertain to the article, but could you give the general public that's watching on TV, most people don't even know a fire truck's coming. Can you explain? It must be a Class A pumper. It'll be the first pumper going out, I would imagine. And is it replacing something, too?
Well, actually, this truck was spec'd out to replace two vehicles. It's going to replace a 1987 rescue truck. That was received from Amherst it was transferred over from Amherst. So that vehicle will be coming offline. And then it's also going to be taking the place of our engine 2, which is up in North Hadley right now, which is a 1987 Pierce. We are keeping that as a backup pumper. Our fleet is definitely aging. That's why we've been putting numbers in early into our capital plan. That the 2001 ladder truck that we got, we're looking at a 15-year-old truck now, and every year the maintenance just on that truck is increasing. We have a 2006 pumper. That was the last truck that we purchased. We're averaging between $8,000 and $10,000 a year on maintenance costs on each one of those vehicles. That's for the inspection, the testing of the equipment on it. And you know, there's no other way around it. We cannot not do that testing. We're putting the town at a huge liability if we're not doing that, plus the general repairs. So that was the purpose of that truck, was to take two trucks and bring it all into one. We've designed a truck that is not a lot bigger than our engine 3. the new technology out there, the increased sizes of these axles, the weight that they can take, the storage abilities, the arrangement of the pump. The truck that we're actually getting right now can actually pump water while it's driving, which is it's an unbelievable option that shrinks. It shrinks the area that the pump has to sit in. So we spent close to 6 months designing this truck to make sure it was right, because you know we're replacing two trucks. It's a big cost, but it's a cost that's going to have everything on the truck brand new, so we won't be coming back asking for more hose, asking for more tool, asking for this. It was all spec'd out complete.
Thank you.
And one more point, Holly.
Yep, one.
One more point on the price. I know $500,000 is a lot of money, but where the piece of property that we're looking at is 4 building lots. Now, the very, very minimum for building lot in North Hadley is $125,000 for the minimum building lot and up. So we're getting 10 acres of land, which, and with 4 big building lots, right on the 9 for $500,000. So the price is really reasonable if you consider all the whole aspect of the property, the location, and then the cost of land.
So, Dave, just want to, and so clearly the Finance Committee's gone on record on the affordability issue.
Yeah.
Right, okay. I'm just going to set affordability aside for the moment, not that we have to come back to that, but just for the sake of discussion. So, at this moment, we have an article here, but in order to, if it was the will of town meeting to pass this article actually doesn't do the job that is necessary right now. It would have to be altered to declare the parcel a unique parcel, right?
So let me suggest a course of action. Let me talk with council, see if in this particular case a unique acquisition is even legally possible. The article could be presented to the voters as is. The motion would have to specify the lot and the assessor's map and lot number, and we can present to the voters at that time a particular parcel.
Okay, and then given the fact that, you know, again, we keep talking about the fact that we're trying to come up with an overarching plan, a multi-year plan for all of this, and we keep having these situations where we've got the cart and the horse, and I'm not sure who's in what order anymore, but if this article were deferred until the fall, do we have the same issue that we've had with previous land-related articles where the risk is that the land would no longer be available to the town?
Well,
it's always a risk.
Anything's possible. I can hate to say it, but if we deferred it, there wouldn't be much of a problem to show our interest in it. 61A. Therefore, it's ours for the taking. If we tell them we want it, they got to hold it for it because it's 61A. So that's something that could happen. And if we can't afford it this year, we say, okay, we'll buy it next year, then it's going to be sitting there for another year. But it's got, and there's two contractors that want to buy the property because they want to put 4 houses up there, but they can't right now because it's 61A and we want it. Mm-hmm. Well, I want it.
Potentially, yeah.
Can we reconsider the board's vote for the recommendation at this time, or do you want to let that stand? The past board has recommended 4-1 to recommend it.
On this article?
Yes, and I wonder if there's reconsideration. Would the board reconsider at this time to re-vote again or no?
That can be up for discussion, or we can also have
it's up to the pleasure of the board.
Right, or have it modified at town meeting to the extent that What's the pleasure of the board relative to that kind of new composition? I think in the past we've just let it ride, and then at town meeting, to the extent there's a new board member with a potentially different viewpoint, allowed for it to be clarified then.
my purpose would be.
I'm looking to the veterans here.
I'm willing to leave it on for the taxpayers to decide.
It's fine, I'll go along with that, that's fine.
All right, so David, you said in terms of a course of action, talk to council. Right. So do we want to have any further discussion about the strong opinion of the finance committee?
Well, if we put right into the omnibus budget, if you want. And right now, currently, we've been taxing away on our reviews, and we are planning to meet again this weekend to see if we can't come up with a little closer to being balanced. As you know, the budget is always is really an estimate. It's not real, until all the numbers and all the revenues start coming in as they track throughout the year. It may come to pass that we may have to advise departments that they may have to have a revision of their budgets at fall town meeting, for better or for worse. We don't know at this time, but it's that tight. We are currently somewhere between $120,000 and $130,000 out of balance. And once you remove all the contractual obligations, we start to run into very tight wiggle room in terms of what we can cut and we can promote.
Okay, so are we ready to dive into the budget discussion? Okay, so Mark, do you want to talk about, so I believe when your meeting started, the budget is presented, there was a shortfall of 500 and?
600, it depends on which number you're trying to pull away at.
Right.
And exactly which time you're talking about. You know, as you know, it's a moving target. We're down to, like I said, somewhere around 120, 130, and that's as today. Here in the House Ways and Means Committee, we're $20,000 richer than we thought we were. Mm-hmm. And we're hoping that the state will see its way to grant us higher funds. As a finance committee, we should try and err on the conservative side to be fiscally responsible so that what we present to the town will be a real number, or as real as we can think it might be. We're hoping to finish that work off this weekend.
Okay. So, I mean, I think there are some folks here tonight who are interested in these suggested changes to the budget that arose on Saturday.
Yeah, we're planning on, as we did this year, the OPEB funding. It will be delayed until fall so we can actually see what the cash availability is. Worst case scenario, we may have to shy that down a little bit. The COBRA raises, once again, we may delay those till fall, simply because we're starting to look at, you know, thousands of dollars to take off in the single digits, not tens of thousands, to try and whittle this down even a little further to those as balanced as we can get it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. what else did we do? Little down.
We're saying I was at the meeting, so you can't. Said there are. A couple.
School, yes. you have to remind me on some of these. We decided to pull $75,000, and with the intention that we'll give it back to them in the fall, just to help us get us closer to balance.
How in the fall?
Same as last year. So do you remember what it was we deferred last year?
I think it was
year?
2 years ago. That
2 years ago.
Deferred,
2 years ago.
Yeah. I would have said 140.
Yeah, I thought. Mm-hmm. But following the same process where, and again, the risk is that there aren't sufficient funds available for the funding. But the idea would be to have a recommendation at town meeting from the finance committee that's $75,000 less than your current ask, with the intent that $75,000 would be funded in the fall.
Right.
Right, Mark?
Correct.
Okay.
Would that be prioritized? I mean, are we going to be competing against OPEB funding to get the $75,000 back in the fall?
I think that's something the board would have to discuss, yeah.
I think it would be a priority versus OPEB.
Hopefully, it'll be as it has in the past, and that's all we can hope for.
I think there were some
I think we're still unsettled about some of these taxes coming in from food and things, too, that we have a rough number there, not an actual, so I'm hoping some of that will come in.
Right, and we actually, that was another adjustment that was made, correct, to kind of bridge the gap. I think David had come in with some recommendations on increasing certain revenue line items.
Right.
And going with growth. A higher number.
Yeah, growth in specifically. We also talked about the increases in the fire and police department, that we can maybe phase those in a little slower, so that we won't have to do it starting on July 1st. That maybe over the course of the 6 months or so that we could field those new positions once we had a little more certainty on our availability of cash.
Mm-hmm. So, Mike, did Mike want to speak to that?
Yeah.
Chief Mason. We could have first and second, sorry.
The idea of phasing in was really floated to me just recently. My end game is to get these additional positions so that we can move forward with the plan of not only having enough officers to handle calls, but also work towards dealing with our overtime issue. So if we're all moving in the same direction as far as getting those three positions, I have no issue with that. We're talking about adding people that need to spend six months in the academy anyways. It certainly is going to take a little bit more planning on my part to decide who we hire, how we hire, and when these things are going to happen.
Just to slow down the accelerator a little bit.
Right.
So, Mike, the numbers I had heard that we were kind of bandied about at the Finance Committee meeting, are we talking about $45,000 that would come out of the current ask, or what figures do you have?
You're going to have to forgive me. This is my first go-round looking at these numbers this way. But it looks like the program expansion, since we were asked to submit two separate budgets, essentially, one for level service and one for the expansion, with the amount of money that we are able to pull from inside of our own budget, it looks like the program expansion is listed all the way on the far right, 48,478. Mm-hmm. So I guess what I would suggest is that 91,690 is our level service. So if we're going to move forward with hiring, say, one now, I'm a little nervous about what's going to happen in the fall if we don't have the money for the other two. Mm-hmm. Just because the plan that I put together requires three. We're going to be finishing the budget, with one officer or, say, two officers. I'm certainly never going to say no, but with phasing things in, the plan I put together to get control of the overtime issue is also going to be phased in. There's going to be an incremental increase in that until we can lock these people in.
So, Mike, I just want to clarify, because I think that I had a question after I left the Finance Committee meeting on Saturday, too, and was re-looking at these numbers. When we were whittling down when you were whittling down the $600,000 gap down to what we are now tonight believing to be a shortfall or a deficit of about 130,000-some-odd, I think we had talked about that deferral as being, would help cut into that. But now that I'm re-looking at the spreadsheet, I'm not sure, to Mike's point, that the program expansion was even in there at all.
Well, I think the original discussion was not about the program expansion part being phased in, but the $90,000 phase, and that's what we talked about with the other selectmen. And I think we're willing to look at that and see if that could help out. It does put us in a position where you're taking a risk.
Yeah, I guess maybe I misunderstood the conversation, because the way I understood it when we were speaking with Mr. Morin was that the expansion is what was going to be phased in. And the way I see the numbers, just like Holly said, that 91 and 690 is, that's what we need to just continue. 48, 478 is what we're looking at in addition for those extra positions. Mm-hmm. So we can certainly hire with this additional, but we're eating into our own level service budget at that point with monies that aren't guaranteed in the on the other end.
So that phase in, I just want to be clear, then that's actually not going to, it's not that it shouldn't be considered anyway, but it's not going to be helpful in reducing the current.
It's a very risky course to take. I mean, it's one thing to be risky with our OPEB contribution. We could coast for a year or so if we had to. It's not ideal. But here we're talking about the provision of services that where people's lives depend upon. This is no fooling around kind of stuff. So.
To the point that that's where the Finance Committee is now, is looking at things that we do want to really go after. Mm-hmm. But got to try and figure out how to get it closer to being balanced.
So if the revenue aren't coming in next year, and
if
state aid goes down,
yeah,
then what are you going to do if you're recommending these phase-ins?
You either cut services, right, cut time. Last thing you would do in dire distress, and you're not hearing it come out of my lips, you're going after
an option available is or an override.
Yeah, or an override.
Mm-hmm. Right. You typically wouldn't do an emergency override to cover an operating.
If you look at the revenues projected for next year, you're looking at another $1 million additional,
mm-hmm,
to what we're bringing in this year.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, we're going to be at 18 million this year to run this town. Right, so we're going to be over 19 million next year. I mean, we have to, as a town, grow according to our revenues, not what we'd like to see, but according to what the money we have coming in. When, right now, if you look at it, you know, if you look at the consumer price index or the Social Security's COLA or the any other measure of inflation, right, then you'll see that the economy is relatively flat, right, 1% or less. The tax rate's going up 2.5%. So as an entity, the town is actually doing pretty well relative to the adjacent economy. So what we've got to do is tether it, our growth, to make sure that it fits the revenues.
Just before we get too far away, I mean, we just threw, I'm just recognizing, because I'm sitting looking at three school committee members, we kind of tossed out a $75,000 potential reduction to their ask. There were a couple of questions asked, but we didn't really allow them to speak to the impact of that. So does anybody from school committee want to do that?
We were going to publish those, give those back to the departments after Saturday's meeting, and then wait for the rebuttal.
Mm-hmm.
Give everybody an opportunity to rebut.
Okay. If you have an immediate reaction.
Two immediate reactions. Number one is, I feel like we all sat in this room. Granted, we have a new finance committee, so it's a different composition of finance committee, but we sat in this room in 2014 and we projected how our fiscal years were going to look, and we projected this problem for fiscal year 17. My memory is we projected this problem in fiscal year 17 almost exactly the problem that we have right now. The dollar amount, we knew we were going to be short this amount in 17, and we as a town have done nothing to address this. We talk about wanting our police to be stronger. We talk about our fire wanting to be stronger. We talk about the importance of keeping our schools. We can't afford to do those things until we do something to find a way to bring more revenue in. So if I have to be the first one to say that I think we need to think about a 2.5 override, because we can't keep cutting our services, we can't keep promising that we are going to increase our police year after year after year and not do it. We've voluntarily taken 148, we didn't even come to you with the level services budget. We voluntarily came to you with a budget that was $148,000 less than level services. I understand we're one town, and I understand we have a shortfall, and I understand we all have to figure out how to deal with that shortfall. But I feel like I say this every year, we can't keep going down this path. We can't keep pushing the can down the road and not addressing the problems in this town.
Well, to your point, I mean, we've run out of, and you're right, it was predicted, and it was frighteningly accurate. For a change, we're actually pretty close to where we thought we'd be right now. But the, you know, I think the thing that's different this year than it was perhaps last year is that last year we still had those opportunities in terms of free cash coming in. And when we made changes last year, we further predicted that we would not have that level of free cash, so that if we were sitting here like we are right now, it would be far more risky. And that, and you're right, it's exactly the way that it's played out, so.
There's an article in the paper tonight about Belchertown and being short 1.9 million. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So okay. We're not alone.
No.
So is that what we're aiming for? We're going to be 1.9 million in the hole?
No, we don't want to aim for that.
Is this what you're telling
me? It's not a goal. That's not a goal.
Okay. I'd just publicly like to thank Mr. Kopacki and the new members. They really accepted a tumultuous task before them, and it's really a difficult situation here to balance this budget. There's so many things in here that are hypothetical. I can just say that, like new growth for solar panels that are coming in, we're estimating 12,000. Hopefully it'll be done by July 1st. If it isn't, we're out that 12,000. Motel tax, they're plugging in 10,000. I don't think Texas Roadhouse is going to bring us that much money, believe me. Medical marijuana, we're plugging in 14,000. We haven't even taken a vote to see if we're going to accept it yet, but that's another 14,000.
They don't even have a permit from the state yet.
We're plugging in $37,000 in meal taxes from the football stadium and Mullen Center, which is almost an impossibility. Amherst has tried it right along and they're not getting anywhere with it, and the state is just too powerful. That's $80,000 we got plugged in there. I'm inclined to agree with her 100%. We have to begin discussion. They have 327 hypothetically plugged in for free cash right now. We're not even close to that. And they're saying it's gonna come to 500,000. That's not going to happen, because everybody's going to be spending their 216 budgets, because they're aware they're not going to have any money for 217. So we're not going to be getting money back from anybody's budgets, in my estimation. So we really have a real tough task in front of us. And I think we might have to start talking about an override. We really have to.
You can't have an override, 2.5 override for operating budgets. You're putting into place things that we want to carry on throughout the years. An override budget is not for the purpose of operation. You can't do that, because what are you going to do the following year after you've used your money for operations?
You're talking about a one-time.
One-time override. I mean, you're not going to be able to do that year after year, because these things will still be in place every year. Yeah, so that's what you have to look at.
We have to manage our borrowing too.
Yes.
Yeah, we're paying $1 million in principal and interest every year right now. You know, and we're talking about borrowing that another $500,000 for that land. Well, that increases the amount of debt that we're gonna have to pay, right? So every time we borrow and take more money, then we have less for the operational budget.
Right, but if you, I mean, unfortunately, we're also at the tail end of not having planned well decades before, has put us in the situation where we're now dealing with all this deferred maintenance on buildings.
So we
gotta, I think you have to have a happy balance there.
We've got to get to 2020, right, when there'll be a significant amount of debt leaving, right? That money could be used for operational expenses.
Or you continue to invest. I mean, again, we're, just to bring it back to one of the opening comments during the public comment period, I mean, we have pretty significant issues that haven't even been quantified and discussed yet, the most significant of which is the infrastructure.
I agree.
Right. So I guess just from my standpoint, I'm just thinking, I think we've got two issues. We've got, to Donald's point, the overarching issue of, again, it's not even long-term planning anymore, it's become quite imminent planning relative to, we either need to increase the pie, need to increase the revenue, or we need to decrease our expenditures, which would have to be at this point a cut in services and likely personnel, or some sort of combination of the two, all the time continuing to try to look for efficiencies in operations. But then we have the May 5th, when's our town meeting? So that's one, and in my mind, of course, the most important issue, but then we also have to deal with this on May 5th and present a balanced budget. So question is, I mean, are folks suggesting that there's an appetite to make dramatic cuts right now or discuss cuts in services today? Or do we want to try to get a little bit creative, and I'm just going to call it like it is and say buy ourselves some more time until we can present something more meaningful at fall town meeting and present a better picture to the town cabinet.
In fall town meeting, you have your numbers. We're not speculating. The number is there. If you got to cut, you got to cut. Here is the number. It's not speculating. It's not cutting budgets today where maybe potentially we won't have to in the fall. I'm a fan of getting us through the 5th and getting us to fall town meeting when everybody sits in the same room again and says, here's our fix, not our numbers. We're not guessing anymore. Let's get us to that point where the fixed numbers are there so that we can make decisions then. And those decisions have to be wholesale decisions that are going to have to affect each and every department that's there.
Exactly.
You know, before what really bothers me, manager, oh, I didn't hear him talking, I couldn't hear him.
You know, before you even start, you're talking about cutting, and in one breath, and in your next breath, you're expanding services. If you don't expand the services, and the budget looks better next year, which it really doesn't look like it's going to. It hasn't looked better in the first 3 years I've been on the board, and it certainly don't look good for the next 3 years.
But Jim,
so if we don't control our spending now, how do you think we're going to control our spending in the next 3 years?
Yeah. Can I clarify? Because I think there's an important distinction here. I actually am not necessarily a fan of the concept of equally shared pain. I think it has a time and a place, but I think we're way beyond that. So when we're talking about cutting services in one breath, and you're right in saying expanding services in another, I'd rather put it in the context of this town has to make choices. And there may be services that the town of Hadley feels very strongly need to be expanded. And I'm not going to presume how town meeting would feel about that. We need to get that information in front of townsfolks so that they can then determine whether or not they're willing to let go of other services. You know, I mean, just the DPW, for example, it's not something we do, but in some towns, they have curbside pickup.
Yeah.
People are willing to pay for curbside trash pickup. We don't happen to have it, but I mean, it's somewhere along the line, somebody said, yeah, we don't want to do that anymore, and they dropped the service.
What really bothers me is last year taking $504,000 from free cash, leaving $2.39. We've taken all kinds of money from our enterprise funds, depleting them. Mr. Kapaki just stated a little earlier, if we get in trouble, we're going to take money from stabilization. Those are the three areas that Standard & Poor's look at when we set our bonding. And we're looking at trying to borrow all kinds of money here in the near future for buildings, libraries, fire upgrades, when they come to look at us, our borrowing is, the rates are going to be exorbitant because we don't have any reserves left in those areas. And that's really going to penalize us.
Okay, so any other comments from board members? I mean, and again, I'm just trying to bring it back to, we have a task at hand, which is the May 5th date. And then I think everybody's articulating that, yep, we hit the wall that we predicted. And this board and the finance committee and obviously the school committee as well, I think, whether we resurrect the tri-board or not, but we need to do something collectively to start addressing these issues immediately. And it's going to be some very painful discussion about services and staffing.
You know, and just like Mark said, everything's been flat for the last 3-4 years probably. You know, if this is affecting the taxpayers right now and the override gets voted down, we've got major issues we're looking at here.
Absolutely.
Something else to be concerned with, the last 3 months, the Department of Revenue's figures have averaged being off 18% a month. So when we get our cherry sheets back, if it keeps going that trend, it's going to be reflected in our cherry sheets also.
You're talking about at the state level?
Yes.
The state level.
The revenues are not coming in right now. We're starting actually, if you look at it realistically, we're actually probably going into a mini recession, mm-hmm. I think. And it's not going to get better. Fortunately, in the last few months, everybody was handed a $1,000 bill, and they spent it. They went out to eat. They took vacations. And I'm referring to the low gas prices and oil prices. How many people took that money and put it in the bank? Maybe 5%? It's gone. And now gas is going up. Oil is going up. And we don't have the expenditures. You're going to see everything's tightening up again. You can see it slowly happening.
So could I suggest that for the first select board meeting after town meeting, and I know we just need to set our schedule tonight, but for that first meeting that we have an agenda item that's dedicated to, again, coming up with a plan as to how we're going to address this, what steps we're going to take. Would everybody be comfortable with that? And that would involve finance and schools to the extent you want to.
Can I make one last comment? And one other thing, everybody's painting the picture, it looks pretty good, and the reasoning why is because we're in an election year. Both the Democrats and Republicans don't want to talk recession now. They want to get reelected, you know, and that's why they're painting the picture. It's rosy, the economy, but it isn't.
Okay, so how does the board feel about putting that on as the priority agenda item for the meeting after town meeting?
Sure.
Everybody comfortable with that?
Yeah,
with
the other two
I just assume to take a break for a couple weeks.
Truth
be said.
Okay. We'll talk more about that.
School committee, you guys really missed us, didn't you?
We did.
Can't wait to come back.
Yes. Thanks for inviting us.
So just coming back to the May 5th issue at hand. So you're going to be meeting again on Saturday, correct, the finance committee?
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to take another go around. If we had to, you know, just read the tea leaves here, what's the likelihood in your minds that you're going to be bridging that $130,000 deficit?
We're going to hope that it's close enough.
Close enough being what?
Close enough to being balanced.
Okay.
That's our goal.
Okay, and if not?
We'll make a statement to that in that tone to the town meeting.
Okay, and theoretically,
that we be banking on the revenues by the state that we have underestimated.
Mark, we look like we have a meeting on the 27th. So do you think we can?
We have a meeting here on
the
27th.
Yeah.
Oh, my calendar is full.
Maybe we can.
Yeah. We can discuss it some more.
Finalization
before
town meeting.
Yeah, that'd be good.
And theoretically, just the way that would look is that we would effectively have a theoretically balanced budget that was reliant on a reduction, either an increase in revenue or a reduction in expense during that subsequent fiscal year. So it would be an unidentified balanced budget.
playing poker, but, you know, a little bit with it, but not, not in a way that, that we would put the town at risk.
Okay.
You know, it really, really seems to me that you folks know we're short on everything. We're short on funding public safety, we're short on this, we're short on everything you're talking about. So why don't you go for a permanent override and ask the taxpayers at this town meeting if they want to increase their tax and fund, whether it's the police, the fire, all the departments, none for him. But that, to me, would ask the taxpayers first if they want to increase the thing. Maybe that'll solve all your problems.
Well,
and we'll
I think
know what
that
direction we're going to be headed.
You don't know what your numbers are.
Right, you don't know what the numbers are. And I, so I think what we have talked about, we just hadn't really committed to, but hopefully we can make a decision one way or the other collectively.
But you've
later
known,
on.
You yep. have known over the years that you're headed downhill.
Sure, but we can only look forward at the moment, John. So what we have talked about is trying to put the financial information of the town together in such a way that we're taking the SWOT analyses that our department has spent so much time on and produced excellent information, coupled with the actual cost of operations for those departments, and conduct a series of meetings for the public, because nor do we want people showing up at town meeting making such significant decisions based on sound bites. I mean, we want to give them as much information as possible, and we have to work very hard to get that information together and presented in such a way that it's meaningful for the taxpayers. I mean, that, again, that's my opinion, but I think that's something that
no,
we want to talk
I
about.
No, I think that's the key thing, is prior to that town meeting, so the voters and the taxpayers know exactly what it's going to cost them and why it's going to cost them.
Right, and we just can't do that for the spring town meeting, so we're discussing doing that for a future.
There is so much on the agenda for the fall town meeting for people to make a choice.
For fall town meeting?
Well, for fall, for all these projects that are coming through, on how they want to increase their taxes and for what do they want to increase their taxes. So, you know, you either got to be champions of one thing or another. You know, you want to do these old buildings, you want to bulldoze them down. You want to do something else with the, you know, increase our public safety. You know, these are choices that the people are going to have to make.
With dollar amount
and impact dollar amounts
attached.
And what
exactly.
they're going to get attached
yes.
to, and how much do they want to increase their taxes.
Right.
That's not an easy thing to do here.
Historically, overrides have not been successful.
That's right.
I don't really care why the tri-board was disbanded, and it's irrelevant now. That's water over the dam. But I would like to ask the members that are here from the school committee and the finance committee, how do you feel the Department of Revenue is very emphatic about a town having a tri-board? All of the towns and the 351 of them, because the school budget is 42%. It's almost equal to the town side. And to keep abreast of each other's issues and what's transpiring, you have to do it on a monthly basis to stay abreast of everything. And I wonder what your feelings are. Would you consider reinstating the tri-board if we suggested it?
You'd probably have to bring that up at a meeting, wouldn't you?
Right.
But that's just their feeling, just to talk their opinion, how they would feel. I heard all kinds of things. Scheduling was the reason why it was disbanded. I don't think it really was. But there had to be some reasoning, and like I said, it's irrelevant to me now.
Well,
but
in the spirit of Molly's comment, looking forward, I think we would support being part of that. We would welcome being part of that board.
I mean, it was a lot of long meetings, and I think everybody was more on the same page at the time with the old finance committee, the school committee, and the board at the time, of where everybody was at. And that's how we came to the conclusion we were heading for a disaster here,
yep.
which we're in right now,
yep.
you know?
We were heading for disaster 15 years ago.
Well, exactly.
And we'll be heading for disaster in 15 more
yeah,
years.
Yeah, exactly.
The sky is falling, the sky is falling, every year.
We had
okay,
a disaster
so
when I was on school committee. I mean, it just, you know, They cut out junior high sports one year when Joyce West was on the committee. I mean, so I mean, it goes way back. This is nothing new.
So where does that leave us then on the warrant? So you're expecting us to sign the warrant tonight. The omnibus budget remains unresolved, and we'll have to do a final vote on the 27th, it sounds like.
Okay.
Determine what direction we're going to go in there.
So yes, so the warrant can be posted now. You have enough pieces in place. The voters can be given adequate heads up as to what the town meeting business items are going to be. So I make a recommendation that we post the warrant, that we sign the warrant, subject to a couple of revisions along the way.
Right.
Right now, the planning board is going to be meeting on the 19th in order to tweak the technical changes suggested by council on their articles. The chief and I need to put our heads together with respect to the bylaw. You and I had some email correspondence on that today. And then we have that issue about the land in North Hadley. So I make a recommendation that we sign the warrant tonight. I'll withhold posting it subject to the technical changes by the planning board, by town council, by the chief of police having to do with the bylaw. And we'll have it posted sometime next week.
When's 21 days?
We have with the annual town meeting, you have to post a week in advance.
I'll make a motion to sign the warrant with provisions to be made.
Is there a second?
There is a second.
Okay. Any discussion?
I've got something. Last week, the board voted to recommend the approval of the article making HPAT a self-supporting enterprise fund.
Yes.
And I spoke to attorney Bill Solomon today, the lawyer who handled our
About time Richard's on television.
Well, I was last week when I had my assistant here. Anyway, he's the lawyer who handled the license negotiations with Charter.
Mm-hmm.
And his recommendation as far as handling HPAT's funding in the future is to wait until next year to make a decision, and wait until the Department of Revenue decides how they think the best way is to handle it.
Mm-hmm.
So my request would be to either remove that article from the warrant or make a motion on town meeting floor to pass over it.
Okay. Did he say there was anything wrong with the proposal? I mean, we vetted this, that it's very legal to do what we're doing, right?
Right, so I had a conversation with council this afternoon about that particular article. It passes legal muster.
Okay. Well, what's the appetite of the board?
What did he say?
He said it passed legal review with town council.
Okay.
Town council,
huh?
Yeah. What's the pleasure of the board?
Let's leave it alone. Council will be on town meeting floor, right?
Yeah, if there's any questions at that point, they can ask
them
right there.
They can stand and ask them right there.
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Okay.
And we'll give them a heads up that that will be an ongoing issue.
Okay.
So what is it you're going to do?
We're going to let it stand the way it is right now,
yeah.
But because town council will be
mm-hmm.
there at town meeting, to the
yeah.
extent any questions are raised from the floor,
mm-hmm.
He'll be able to address them then.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm sorry, Mr. Spank, our Chief Spanknebel.
That's fine.
Okay.
Mike and I just had a question in regards to Article 14. We had talked with you about the, I just remember the Oreo cookie filling getting pulled out of Article 14.
Right.
It was in regards to the walkways and the safety complex for access. The funding that was requested in that.
You're talking about the catwalks?
Yeah. I was just wondering if there was a plan in place for that. I haven't heard anything.
Yeah, so we have money for the catwalks available right now without town meeting vote, and we've made that a priority, so.
With the roof?
Not the roof. This is for the catwalks, for the installation of the AC, the HVAC controls.
But we did put the roof in as a priority last week.
Yes, the roof.
Thank you.
All right, we have a motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Oh, sign of war? As pending except for those three, right?
Yeah, yep.
All right, yeah, aye.
Okay, so unanimous? Okay, thank you. And I do just, I want to err on the side of full disclosure, since this is my first night being chair. The next meeting on the 27th, I am actually going to be at a conference out of town. I will not be here, but I assure you, it is not a cowardly act. It's just a scheduling conflict, and I will be as engaged as possible with you, the Finance Committee, leading right up to that.
Fun and games.
Don't worry, I'm still here.
Did you have any?
We have the clarifier contract to do still.
We have the Hadley Hall.
Right, I was gonna say, and then we also have the bid that came up to do.
Which one are we doing?
Well, why don't we do the North Hadley Hall first?
All right.
A little money, Linda.
So as the board knows, the town went out to bid for proposals to, for somebody to purchase North Hadley Village Hall. We received two proposals, one from the North Hadley Congregational Church and the other one from Mr. Joel Greenbaum. The subcommittee was formed by the board, and they spent quite a bit of time on Tuesday talking about the two proposals without looking at the prices. And it was a very thoughtful discussion about the need of the community, what was good for the village center, what defined the community up in North Hadley, and how responsive were the two proposals to the to those concerns. Do you want to add anything more? You were in charge there.
I just think we had a good discussion on it, and actually it came down to money and what would be helpful with our tax base as it comes back to us, as long as it stays some type of historical building in North Hadley, and how it's going to be taken care of.
Could you reiterate the makeup of the committee, please?
It was myself, Chief Spankenable, Ginger Goldsberry from the
resident,
not as a historical member.
David
Waskevich and Andy Kopacki.
And Ms. Linda Ziegenbein, who wasn't able to be there, representing historical. The committee came up with a ranking of the two proposals, again, without looking at the prices, based solely on their qualifications and how responsive they were to the needs of the community.
And the proposals that came to us.
Right, right. So the committee unanimously ranked Mr. Greenbaum as the most preferred proposer, and the North Hadley Congregational Church is the second most preferred proposal, recognizing that both had fine plans for North Hadley Village Hall. Afterwards, we opened up the prices. The proposals were ranked by price, and again, Mr. Greenbaum had the highest amount of money to offer to the town at $72,000. And the North Hadley Congregational Church had the next highest, which was $2,500. So I recommend that the board take this information under advisement. It's not on the agenda, but we should place it on the next agenda for action by the board.
Does everybody agree to that?
Just a point of interest. Mm-hmm. Now, I've heard discussion. Does that include the whole piece of property, or is some being segregated off?
Right now, Mr. Greenbaum's proposal is for the whole piece of property.
Okay.
May I also ask too, if I, maybe I made this up, but I thought I remember, in the proposal, when, in part of the evaluation criteria, wasn't there just a question as to whether or not they might be willing, like from a timeline standpoint, would they be willing to allow us to maintain equipment for some amount of time? Did I not remember that? Or?
Right, that was part of both proposals. Mr. Greenbaum is allowing the fire department to stay until the time of construction begins. That was one of the things that we talked about, is how quickly would we be signing a purchase and sale agreement, and we all recognize that it's going to take 6 months to get that paperwork all organized. We still don't have the final historic preservation restriction information. Mm-hmm. I will reach out to the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission to find out where that is at this point. So I can't imagine Mr. Greenbaum's going to sign a purchase and sale agreement without that final document in place.
At what point in time do we go beyond that? I mean, we've been asking for that now for how long?
For
the historical preservation?
A year.
Okay.
So, I mean, who can we apply? Do we talk to Stan Rosenberg? Do we talk to the governor's office? I mean,
right.
How do you?
I think your legislative delegation are the people that you talk to, and it's the Massachusetts Historic Commission that ultimately would be issuing those.
Don't you remember how long it took for the Verizon Tower from them?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah. So Senator Rosenberg and Representative Seibel.
Second.
Yep.
Okay. All right. Okay. So everybody good on that?
Uh-huh. Can I ask a question? Are you done, Mike?
With the meeting or?
No, with about the proposal for the North Elmwood.
Yes.
Oh, so I can.
Don't you want to ask something?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was asking if you were done with the discussion on.
Well, we've already made our decision.
Okay.
Right.
But if you would like to ask
something, if you wanted to
ask
her.
Well,
comment.
I'm just wondering if you're going to sell it for $73,000. Is that my understanding?
72.
So this is actually something that the board shouldn't make a decision on yet, because it's not posted in your agenda. And so you may find that you're not interested in that mm-hmm. price, but this should be discussed at a meeting where it's on your agenda.
Okay, so we're taking it under advisement tonight, but to the extent you want to, you can either come to the meeting when we have it posted for discussion.
Sure.
You're always welcome, Maureen.
Sure.
Okay, thank you for catching that.
Yeah.
Okay.
So no question. I can't ask any questions. We'll come back when it's on.
You could really
deck.
Ask a question under the public comment portion, although we
don't have
any
answer to it.
We don't have any answer for it. But
I'm not saying that the question can't be answered or asked, but I'm saying you're don't make
no
a decision
has been made.
Yeah.
Because
right.
You're going to have to
you can still ask the question
justify that later.
Comment.
Okay,
yeah.
All right. Maureen, ask away.
Okay, so if you're going to sell it for $72,000, wouldn't it make sense to keep it, demolish the building, and have it for another service such as the fire department?
Exactly.
Valid point.
And then it would probably be that much to demolish the building mm-hmm. rather than give it. It seems like if it's valued at $400,000.
Oh, the assessment was actually $400,000 right?
$438,000.
So if it's valued at that much, and yet it seems like you're giving it away.
But a price tag of $2 million for renovations that we did a study on.
Right. So if you're keeping the existing building, she's saying rip it down.
Yeah,
start
she's
new.
Saying raise it.
And then where are we going to get the money to rip mm-hmm. it down?
Well, you want $500,000 for a piece of property.
I know. But we've already went to town meeting and have a vote to sell it.
We own that property.
I think the point of
went to town meeting.
I didn't mean to
go
to the head vote.
No, I think the point of
to sell it. Well, you can go back to change it, can't you?
Terry, just I think the point of David's comments is that we're taking it under advisement now, and these are all good things that should be discussed at the point that the board is deliberating on this. When it's posted and we have time to get all of that information in front of us. So, good question. John?
I agree that young lady over there, knocked that for $72,000, knocked that down, put a Butler building, and if the fire department needs a standby station for now, then it can be repurposed later. But why are you giving something away? The land is worth far more than that.
Okay, so we'll commit to taking that into consideration when we have the discussion on the agenda.
When is the discussion going to be?
We haven't set the future agenda yet, so.
If it's set, and the building committee would like to know because they have all those answers.
So I think that's the whole point is that we're talking about something that we haven't given people proper notice.
Proper notice, yeah.
Okay, the folks up North Hadley may have a an opinion on this. That they got to be notified, so we got to put this on an agenda so that proper public notice can go out to everybody, so that everybody who is interested in it has the opportunity to come and hear and be heard.
So not the 27th.
Okay.
Right. I mean, in all likelihood, it's not going to be on that quickly.
Right.
I mean, does anybody disagree?
No.
I think another area we have to consider we need time to discuss is the demolition. That could be well over $100,000 with the asbestos in the building and everything else. So it's a big ticket item to tear that down. You just don't say tear it down. It costs an awful lot of money to tear it down.
Everybody put on your thinking caps between now and then if you want to try to put...
We need a fire drill.
The value of...
We need a fire drill.
We need a fire drill.
That's what I said 2 years ago.
Terry, did you have something?
Yeah, I was just curious if you know what Mr. Greenbaum would like to do in the building.
Joyce, you want to speak to that? The proposal?
Fire drill?
No, she wanted to... Terry's asking what Mr. Greenbaum's proposal was proposing to do with the building.
Oh. I don't know if I have it. No, it's in my car. He was proposing some studio apartments, some community space on the ground floor.
Pot dispensary.
Another one.
Sorry, neighbor.
Well, it's my house.
I'll walk away.
He was offering apartments.
He was offering apartments. He was open-ended on what it could be mixed of studio apartments with one bedrooms for professionals, graduate students for single-person occupancies. An open mind, alternative uses for the first floor of the main hall. If there are any local organizations or businesses that would be interested in space or community space on the first floor, I am receptive to ideas and could build to suit. And he you know, his name of his business is Historic Renovations and Rental Properties. So that's where he's coming from. We actually had renderings of his drawings of what he had decided to do. He would, the current firehouse doors would be reframed to accept doors exiting onto private patios, two decks on the east side of the building, putting in windows where they were blocked off in the building, you know, where they have done those things. So he has, you know, certain ideas where on the other proposal, there wasn't any specifics on what to do with the building or where the funding was coming from.
Thank you.
There's no question in my mind if he took that bid, it'd be a beautiful building. He owns in my neighborhood, I live across the street as Terry lives next door. He owns 8 to 10 buildings in that neighborhood, and they're just maintained explicitly, you know, so. There'd be no question in my mind. He owns 170 houses between Hadley and Amherst that he rents out. So he's...
Okay, we're ready to move on to the final agenda item. Then I think we may have a little bit of housekeeping after that. But the next item is the clarifier upgrade and refurbishment. The construction services proposal, David?
Right, so we're currently out to bid for the to clarifier upgrades for the wastewater treatment plant. The sub-bids will be open this Friday. The general bids will be open on the last Wednesday of the month. So we'll know our prices at this point. We have $207,000 set aside for this project out of the sewer impact. fees. Ty and Bond has submitted a proposal for construction services for a flat fee of $10,000. Mr. Warner has reviewed this and agrees that we should sign this agreement. These services will be needed for that kind of a technical upgrade. And the money would be coming from the budget allocated for the project.
So it's $10,000 that we're voting on this evening?
That's correct.
Construction administration and construction observation. So, second conversation.
Do we still have some discussion?
Yeah, for conversation.
Yeah. I'm just wondering, why do we only have one bid?
It's engineering services. We don't have to bid it out.
But wouldn't it behoove us to ask other people to see if this is a qualified bid?
I think that,
We could get it much cheaper?
I think that you can certainly do that. Ty and Bond designed the clarifiers that are supervising the bid, so it may not be in our best interest to change an engineering firm on a project that's in progress.
I didn't realize he did the initial part.
Another question? Any other conversation about this?
Yeah, are they painting it or are they sealing it? And who made that decision?
The engineers would have made that decision.
So you're going with a 8-year paint job rather than a 30-year sealing job? That was in a discussion 10 years ago, yeah.
I don't have that information off the top of my head.
It has nothing to do with what we're voting on, though. Right?
Is that something we could get clarification from Marlo on? Okay.
I'd just like to know the reason behind it. We're going to be painting this thing every 8 or 10 years, as we've been in the past, rather than sealing it up forever, you know?
Right.
At a little bit more additional cost to what the cost of these two tanks are right now. I know myself, I had brought a bunch of quotes in, and we had discussed it back with the sewer commissioners were active. And
when there was a real sewer commission?
When they were actually determined that
real.
You know, in a long run, we were better off sealing real. The tanks up for a longer period of time. You know, the way the quality of the paints and sealants are right now, pretty much every wastewater treatment plant around are doing major sealing projects, not painting projects.
Could you ask Marlo for an opinion on that, and maybe
right.
just once you have it, just send it to us?
Absolutely.
I just don't think it's in the best interest of the town to paint mm-hmm. rather than seal.
Sure. No, it's good. Okay. But to Jerry's point, so that shouldn't preclude us from voting on
right. That's
room in hand.
That's a design issue with that. It's not what's in front of you. This is a construction supervision issue.
Okay, so we have a first and second on the floor. Ready to vote? Mm-hmm. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Upstate.
Excellent.
Point of information?
Yes, sir.
I'd like to thank John Mitch for the author of the impact fee to get all this extra money.
Duly noted.
That was a political plug.
Duly noted. Okay. So that's the last of the regular agenda items, but I do think from an administrative standpoint, we need to set the schedule for, and also just prior to that, currently we have assignments as liaisons to departments, just for, you know, certainly at least through town meeting. It would be my suggestion that we don't change those assignments for the time being, and then I would just ask if, unless Mr. Pipchinski has an issue, I believe Guilford had he was liaison to HPAT and the schools. Would you be willing to accept
that? That'd be fine.
Okay, all right, so is everybody comfortable staying the course for now?
Why don't we just make that a motion, and then as long as it works for everybody. I'd like to make that motion that Mr. Pipchinski takes over Mr. Mooring's responsibilities and go forward with what we have today for liaison appointments.
Second.
Okay. Second? Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, thank you. Okay, calendar. So April 27th is a...
Get your cap on.
No meeting next week, the 20th.
No meeting on the 20th, and then looking forward to the month of May. David, are we looking to do it for the remainder of the fiscal year, or just?
Well, if we can get through the next four or five meetings, that would be enough for right now. We can take a breather after town meeting. You typically meet on the first, second, and third Wednesdays of the month. The first Wednesday of May would be the day before town meeting. So you want to meet on, or to have a short meeting?
Yes.
So we could put a placeholder in there, just in case something comes up, have a short meeting?
Yeah.
Okay.
See if there's.
Okay, so that would be the 4th, the 11th, and the 25th? Is that right?
Fourth, 11th, and 18th.
Oh, and 3rd, I'm sorry. Okay.
Are you meeting next week?
No.
Okay.
All right, does anybody have any issue with those dates, first, second, and 3rd?
Second and 3rd.
And then the other.
First, second, 3rd? Is that what you're doing now?
Yeah.
Even after budget, we're going to do that?
Well, I think what we're doing right now is we're putting it for the month of May, we're putting those on the 4th, quite frankly, I think is more of a, if we have anything last minute that needs to be taken care of in advance of town meeting. Yeah, so we'll get it posted and be there, and then we can have further discussion about this at one of those meetings.
Well, it should list it as an agenda for the second Wednesday in May.
Yep. Okay. Is that okay, Joyce?
This month, May month.
All right, so that's all you needed, David, May?
That's all I need right now.
All right. Anything else?
How about Dr. Kopacki introducing your members? You know, I went to 3-year meetings and I still don't know their first names even. So it'd be nice to just let the public know who they are a little bit.
Amy Fiden?
I know her because Elizabeth Fiden was a school teacher a long time and your husband.
We have Terry Rusko.
Terry, we know, yes.
Who's that?
The one in back, I
Valley,
have no idea.
Valerie Hood.
Hi, Valerie.
Hello.
Thank you.
And absent is Susan.
Susan Rondo.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I get three rookies, myself, and Terry Rusko was it.
They could become a most valuable player, though, being a rookie. You never know.
That's right.
No, never did.
Okay, any announcements?
I'd like to thank all the taxpayers and the voters of town for giving me a chance to serve them for another 3 years. And I hope I live up to the expectations of the people that didn't vote, as I said 3 years ago. Because I guess there's still some that doesn't believe I can do the job. John?
That would be me.
Yeah, I know.
All right.
So, thank you.
Okay. Any other announcements?
I have one. I promised my wife I'd do a better job this week. The Hadley Mothers Club is sponsoring, again, their 11th Recycling Day. It's going to be April 23rd, 2016, from 8 a.m. to 1 p.m. at the Hadley Elementary parking lot, rain or shine. A list of the fees for disposal are extravagant this year. All kinds of appliances can be done. And this year, they really went out of their way to add other things, which are, I guess, are just a little bit different. Cell phones, printer cartridges, VHS batteries, eyeglasses, small line, electronic chargers, modems, routers, cables, and CDs. Pickup is available through the Boy Scout Troop 550. Call Claire at 559-8825. That would be the Boy Scouts coming to pick it up for you if you're unable to deliver it yourself. You can bring your shoes, clothing, sneakers, belts, sheets, pillowcases, and drapes, and stuff the animals for collection. That's the whole of the Most Holy Redeemer, St. Pauli Mission will be receiving them. The Hopkins Academy Boosters Bands will have a bottle and can drive. And the thing I really dropped the ball on last week because I didn't understand what they were doing was the Hadley Hopkins Academy 7th grade class has a class which is really trying to go out there and recycle things that are very hard to recycle. So whilst I was reading it last week and couldn't understand who could possibly recycle a toothpaste tube with caps or toothbrushes or floss containers and floss, apparently the kids have really taken on an opportunity to recycle those really hard to recycle things. So if you had an opportunity to drop that off, it would help those kids as well. So again, that's Hadley Mothers Recycling Day, April 23rd, 8 to 1 at the Hadley Elementary Park. And you can contact Denise Devine if you have any other questions regarding that.
Joyce, any announcements?
No, not tonight.
Not tonight? Mr. Michikowski?
You guys haven't heard from WS Development?
No.
Nothing?
Nothing.
Okay.
All right, there being...
One last one.
Oh, okay, go ahead.
If somebody wants me next week, they're gonna call me in Aruba. We went there on our honeymoon 36 years ago, and we're going back April 18th, so they gotta call me in Aruba.
Your honeymoon is over, pal.
Okay, do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right, thank you. Night, everybody.
Thanks.